Welcome back. This is Dr. Vishal Trivedi from Department of Biosciences and Bioengineering, IIT Guwahati. So let's continue our discussion about the reproduction in sexual reproduction in plants. And in this series of lectures, what we have discussed so far is we have discussed about the flowers. We have discussed about the different parts of the flower, and then we have discussed about the male sex organs and how the pollen grains are being formed within the anther, and we have also discussed how the anther is dispersing the pollen grains. And in this discussion, we were discussing about the self pollinations, and we have also discussed about what are the advantages and disadvantages of self pollinations. And in that context only, we were also discussing about why in some conditions the plants could not be able to go for the self pollination, and in those cases they go for the another mode of pollination, and that is called as the cross pollination. And in this mode of pollination, they always require a agent to facilitate the pollination process. So before getting into the details of what are the agents and how the pollination is going to happen, let's discuss what are the conditions we are there in the plant system which does not facilitate the self pollinations. So in this we have already discussed about the hercogamy. So as we discussed in the previous lecture, what is mean by hercogamy is that it is a kind of a mechanical barrier which is present either on the top of the stigma or on the top of the anther, and that does not allow the spontaneous mixing of these two components. Means it does not allow the pollen grains to reach to the stigma or vice versa, and in these kind of cases the plants have no choice but to go for the cross pollination, because they need a factor which could remove these kind of mechanical barrier to facilitate the pollination. Now the second factor, so what we are discussing about the factors favoring cross pollination. Okay, we have already discussed about the hercogamy, which means mechanical barrier. Now we'll discuss about the second point, and that is called as the dichogamy. So what is mean by dichogamy is that the dichogamy means the maturation in the dichogamy. What is mean by dichogamy is, if you remember in the previous lecture we have discussed that the self pollination is only possible when the anther and the stigma are maturing at the same time. So then only it will go for the self pollination. But what is mean by dichogamy means that the anthers and stigmas are not maturing at the same time, or they are maturing at the different times. So in these cases the anther and stigma is maturing at different times. This means either the anther is getting matured first, or the stigma is getting matured first, and in so either the male sex organ is getting matured first or the female sex organ is getting matured first, and in those of the cases it becomes incompatibility, because if suppose the male sex organ is getting developed, it may not find any of the female sex organs to facilitate the fertilization. In the other case, because it requires the development of both the male sex organ as well as the female sex organ to be developed at the same time, because the Palangrein cannot sit for very long period of time. So the cases where the female sex organ or the gynoecium is getting matured first, the condition is known as the protogamy. Whereas the time when the androecium is getting matured first, the condition is known as the proto-andry. So in both of these cases, these kind of plants have no choice, because they cannot go within the same plant, because either the pollen grain, either the male sex organ or the female sex organ is going to be matured at a different time. So they will not go for the self pollination. They have the only choice to go for the cross pollination, because then they can, suppose the male sex organ got matured, then the pollen of this particular plant can go to the gynoecium of the second plant, and that actually is a kind of a cross pollination. Now the third condition is called as the male sterility. So the third condition is known as the male sterility, in these cases the pollen grains are not functional. Then we have another conditions. The plant is having the unisexual in nature. So in the case of that, this means the male and female plants are different. So in these cases, the male flower is present on the male plant and the female flower is present on the female plant, and in these kind of cases the self pollination is not possible. So these kind of plants has to go for the cross pollination. The example is the papaya. The other factor is heterostyly. Heterostyly is a very very unique conditions. So in the heterostyly, what you have is in the pollen grains in the typical plant, what you have is that the stigma is always on the lower side then to the pollen grains or the anther. So position of the anther is always been on the top of the stigma, okay. But in these kind of, so these are the anthers which are present on the top. So that's how the pollen grains can fall from here and they will go to the stigma of the flower. But in these kind of heterostyly conditions, the stigma of a flower, stigma is very long. So because of that, it does not allow self-pollination. So these are the crucial, some of the crucial factors which actually force the plant to go for the cross pollination. So what is meant by the cross pollination is that you are actually involving the two different plants. So the anther or of the one plant or pollen grains from the one plant will go to the stigma of the another plant, and that's how it will facilitate the fertilization. As you can see on the PowerPoint slide, I have explained how the cross pollination is happening. So in the event of cross pollination, the pollen grains from the one plant is being released, and then they will carry over to the stigma of the another plant. And since this carriage involves the factors, there are multiple factors which are important for facilitating the cross pollination. What are these factors? There are abiotic factors and there are biotic factors. The abiotic factor means the anemophily or the wind pollination, where the wind is involved. So wind will carry the pollen grains from one flower to another flower, whereas in the case of hydrophily, the water will carry the pollen grains from the one plant to another plant. Within the abiotic factors, we have the different types of organism which also facilitate the pollination process. What are these abiotic factors? It could be entomophily, where the insect is facilitating, means insect is carrying the pollen grains from the one flower to another flower. In the other case, it can be ornithophily, where the bird is carrying the pollen grains from the one flower to another flower. And in the rare cases, it is also called as the chiropterophily, and chiropterophily is actually where the bat is involved in the pollination process. So all these we are going to discuss now. So cross pollination. So it is water pollination, air, water, number 3. So these are the part of abiotic, and then you have the insect, you have the birds, and then you have the bat which is involved, and these are the biotic factor. So let's start with the air pollination. So air pollination is happening in air pollination means the travel of the pollen grains from the one plant to another plant by the medium of air. So in these cases, the air is actually carrying the pollen grains from one plant to another plant. As you can see on the PowerPoint slide, I have shown a schematic diagram to explain how the wind pollination is happening. So this is an example of the maize plant, where the pollen grains from the top are being dispersed, and these pollen grains are being dispersed from the male flower, whereas we can see that the female flower is present at the bottom, and then they reach to the stigma. So in these cases, as the name suggests, and as the medium is very very non-specific, because the air is can disperse these pollen grains in any direction, not like it is a kind of a directional movement of pollen grains towards the stigma. These kind of plants are actually producing the pollen grains in a very very huge quantities. For example, a single flower of cannabis, which is actually the bhang plant, is producing more than the 500,000 of pollen grains these, and as the air has to carry these pollen grains from from the anthers to the stigma, these pollen grains are very small, they are light, they are dusty, and sometimes they also contains the wings, so that they can be able to fly within the air to reach the very very long distances. The reports are there that the pollinations or the wind pollination is happening to a distance of 1300 kilometer even. Then the because the air is the only medium to do the pollination, these flowers of these plants are also being well exposed to the air, so that it also allows the removal of the pollen grains from the anther of the main flower, as well as it also facilitate the receiving of these pollen grains by the stigma. On the other hand, the stigma also is very much like a protruding, means stigma is well exposed and it is hairy, so that it actually captures more and more pollen grains which are present in the air. And the examples of these classes are like several types of grasses, sugar cranes, bamboo, coconut, palm, cannabis, and the maize. The maize figure what you have seen here. The in some of the plants such as the urtica plant, the pollen grains which are present in the anther are bursting all of sudden. So, that actually causes a kind of a pressure to release the large quantities of pollen into the air, and this mode of the pollen dispersal is called as the gunpowder mechanism. Means it is like similarly, it is mimicking just like as the we are firing the gun from the pistol. Since these plants does not rely on the other kind of biotic factor, means they do not rely on the insect, bat or bird, the corolla or the calyx of these plants are not very attractive, because they do not have to attract the pollinator which are biotic in nature. So, the calyx and corolla are very much reduced or they are almost absent. The anthers on the other hands are very very versatile, so they are very light, so that as soon as the wind comes, it actually swings the complete plant, and as a result the pollen grains are being released from these plant. The as I said, the common examples are grass, sugarcane, bamboo, coconut and cannabis and maize. Now, we will go back to the another mode of pollination, and the other mode of pollination is called as the water pollination. So, I have shown a schematic example. This schematic example I have taken from the is depicting the pollination, water pollination in the case of Welsineria. So, these kind of flowers, in this kind of mode of pollination also, the transfer of pollen grains from anther to stigma is happening with the medium of air, water. So, as we discussed for the air pollination, the calyx as well as the corolla are very very small, and they do not have any role in the pollination part, because as I said, these are dependent on completely on the abiotic factor, and abiotic factor does not require calyx or corolla. Pollen grains as well as the stigma which are being produced in these plants are water resistant, so they do not get wet by the water, and in this case also the stigma is very long and it is sticky, so that as soon as it takes up the pollen grain, the pollen grain get stick to the stigma, and that is how it will facilitate the fertilization. The example in this category is the Welsineria, Jostera and the Ceratophyllum. So, these three classes are actually following a very very unique and different mechanism. For example, in the case of Welsineria, what is happening is that the flowers which are present in the male flower. So, Welsineria has the male and female, the two different plants. So, the male flower is actually detaching from the male inflorescence, and then it is coming onto the cells, onto the water surface, and then it is floating on the top of surface. And in this, and whereas the female plant is sending its female flower on the top of the surface by the a very long branch, and the by the flow of water, the male flower is coming very close to the female flower, and that's how the pollen grains are being released. And then as it reaches to the stigma of the female flower, and as soon as the fertilization happens, the female flowers are again then retracted back into inside the water by coiling the branch which is connecting the female flower. Whereas in the case of Jostera, the mechanism is very different. In the case of Jostera, the pollen grains are long, elongated, and needle like, and they don't contain the outer covering called as exine. And they float on the surface of the water because in the absence of exine, they normally have the similar density as the water. And as soon as they touches the stigma, they get coiled around it, and then as a result, then it later on it germinates on the stigma, and then that's how it releases the male gametes to facilitate the fertilization. In the case of Ceratophyllum, the male or the female, both flowers are totally submerged, and they contains the stigma as well as the anther. The male anther, which is get abscised at the base, rise upward, reach to the surface of water, and then it descends, and that releases the pollen grain. While sinking in water, they come in contact with long and sticky stigma of female flower to affect the pollinations. So, as you can see, in all the three, in these three classes, the mechanism is very different, but it involves the water, and the although the minute procedures may be very different, but overall system is that the pollen grains are, or the male flower is being released, it floats onto the water, and then it reaches to the female flower, and there it do the dehiscence and releases the pollen grains, and that pollen grains goes and bind to the sticky stigma, and that's how it goes into the fertilization. So these are the abiotic factors which are facilitating the pollinations. Now we'll discuss about the biotic pollination. So, once we talk about the biotic pollination, the first class comes to the insect pollination or insect pollination, where the insects are involved. And since we are talking about the biotic pollination, there are specific criteria which these insects have to follow. So, what are these criteria? Okay, so as we're discussing about the insect pollinations, and insects actually get attracted toward the color, scent, and other kind of molecules. So in those cases, the flowers has to be colored. Flowers are colored. Okay, they should produce scent. The scents actually is kind of a chemo attractant for the insects to attract towards the flower, and as a result the insects goes from one flower to another flower, and that is how they actually do the insect pollination. The flowers produces specific scent or a specific odor, and because of that the flower as well as the insect combination is very very unique in most of these cases of insect pollination. It is not like any random insect is going to the facilitating the pollination. There are insects which are doing the pollination of a class of plants. The third is these flowers are also producing nectar number 4 as I said, you know, the flowers are colored, so it actually produces the color of different flower, so that actually attracts the insect of different types. Number 4, the male or the female flower actually, and in this case the flower actually blossom at a specific time, means the flower actually blossom with the activity of a particular insect. So, the flower blossom at a specific time. For example, there are plants which are blossoming only at the sunset, okay, because they are looking for a particular type of moth which actually is going to facilitate the pollination. In some cases, the pollen grains of these flower of these plants of these flowers are edible. The example are rosa. So, why it is important that the pollen grains should be edible? Because the insects are attracting towards these flowers for 3 reasons. One, because they are looking for a specific flower or a specific color, so that color actually attracts the insects towards them. Number 2, they might be get attracted because the plants are the flowers are producing a specific scent, so that scent is working as a chemoattractant. Number 3, the plants are these flowers are also producing the nectar, so nectar is also actually a solution of sugar, so that also they want to have it for their nutrition. Number 4, if the pollen grains is also a source of food, then the insects will also love to go to these flowers, and in this process they will eat some pollen grains, but they will also facilitate the pollination. On the other hand, because the pollen grains has to travel from one place to another place, these pollen grains are very very rough. Rough and sticky. Why it is important? It is important because these pollen grains normally go and stick to the body of the insect, and that is how they will travel from one place to another place, and that is how they will facilitate the pollination. Let us take an example. So, the classical example in this case is the salvia. So, as you can see on the PowerPoint slide, I have shown a schematic diagram how in the case of salvia the insects are actually facilitating the pollination. So, you can before getting into the details of the insect pollination by the salvia, let us understand first the particular kind of adaptations happens within this flower. So, the salvia is actually having a unique flower where the corolla is bilobed. So because of this bilobed corolla, the lower lobe is working like a platform on which you can see the insect will sit, okay, whereas the top lobe is actually working like a roof. So that actually protects and gives a kind of a covering to the flower. On the other hand, the flowers are protoandrous, means each flower has two epipetalous stamen located anterior posterior in position. Each stamen has a short filament and a elongated curved connective tissue. So you can see that it has the elongated curved connective tissue, and that actually splits the particular anther into two parts, and one part is called as the sterile anther, the other one is called as the fertile anther. So you can see that the connective tissue has bifurcated the anther into two parts. One is called sterile anther, the other one is called as the fertile anther. So the fertile anther is actually with the roof corolla, is toward the roof corolla, and the sterile anther is towards the bottom, towards the floor. So you can imagine that insects, when insects comes, it sits on the lower bottom of the flower. As soon as it sits, it actually causes the pressure, and because of that the connective tissue is getting stretched, and that actually bring down the fertile anther lobe, and that releases the anther, that releases the pollen grain on the back side of the insect. Now imagine that the same insect goes into the another flower. So when it goes into another flower, the back of the insect, which actually is containing the pollen grains, are getting rubbed against the stigma, and as a result the stigma actually receives those pollen grains, and that actually facilitates the fertilizations. So apart from the salvia, apart from the salvia, we have another example, we have several examples where the insects are facilitating the pollination. These are called yucca, orchids and ficus. In any of these examples, the particular mechanism is very, very unique. For example, in the case of yucca, the insects which is participating in pollination is called as the tegeticula, and this particular moth is actually having a symbiont relationship with the yucca, and that actually facilitate into the pollination process. So in this kind of symbiotic relationship, the yucca is providing a space for the insect to live, and on the other hand the insect is facilitating the pollination process. Similar is the condition for in the case of orchids or in the case of ficus, where the flower is providing a breeding environment for these insects, and in return the insect is facilitating the pollination. Now we'll move on to the next class of next type of pollination, and that is called as the bird pollination. So as we have a specific requirement for the insect pollination, we will definitely going to have the insect specific requirement for the bird pollination. So what are these specific requirements for the bird pollination? Number one, see, birds are very, very large in size, okay. So and since they have to come and facilitate the pollination, the first requirement is that the flowers are large in size. Number two, since birds are have to sit within this flower, and then they can actually be able to facilitate the pollination process. The flower should have a funnel shaped corolla. Number three, similar to the insects, since the the birds are also getting attracted towards the color, so this flower also should be bright in color. So this flower should be brightly colored. This flower should have the nectar, and these flowers should not have the scent. So they usually, so birds usually don't like the scent. So they also like, they want that the flower should be without any scent. So the flower should be scentless, but they like to have the nectar, because the nectar is a solution of sugar, and that birds can actually feed on. So the you can see, as you can see on the PowerPoint slide, I have depicted the a typical example of the bird pollination. You can see this is, so the bird is, the bird which are involved in doing the bird pollinations are mostly been the hummingbird or the crow, bulbul, or the parrots. The plants, example of the plants which are actually going through the bird pollinations are bombax, begonia, and agave. So in these cases, what happen is as you can see, this is a kind of a tube like structure. So, and at the bottom of the tube, what you will see is actually a nectar. So what happen is the bird actually wants that particular nectar, and in this process it actually carries the pollen grains from one plant to another plant. Now we'll come back to our last factor, and that is called as the bat. So in the case of bat, again we'll discuss about the criteria, what is important for a bat to facilitate the pollination. So in the case of bat, the most of the criteria are same as what we have discussed about the bird. That means the flowers are large, number two, it should be tunnel shape, number three. Now contrary to the birds, bats are normally being attracted toward the flowers which are dull in color, means the colors should be dull. Not the bright color, because as you know, the bats are actually the nocturnal animals or nocturnal birds, nocturnal animals. So they always remain out in the night. So they actually are looking for the colors which are dull in color. Then similar to the birds, they also looking for the nectars, and they also looking for the contrary to birds, they are looking for the strong scent, because you remember that since they are traveling in the night, they always go to the particular flower either by seeing the flower or by getting the sense of scent. The example in this case are Kijelia pinnata, and there are so many examples which are also given on the PowerPoint slide. So now what we have discussed so far, we have discussed only we have discussed about the self pollination, we have also discussed about the cross pollinations. Now we'll discuss, so as we discussed for the self pollination, the advantages as well as the disadvantages, Now we will also discuss about the advantages as well as the disadvantages of the cross pollination. So, what are the advantages and disadvantages of cross pollination? One of the drawback of the self-pollination is that it does not allow the formation of the new species. So that is actually is always been overcome if you go by the cross-pollination. So if you go by the cross-pollination, you are actually going to, so the plant is going to be mixed. So the two plants which are going into neighbors, they will actually go for the mixing, and that is how they will going to produce the new species. So, it actually allows the genetic recombination and generation of new species. Number two. As I said, since the cross pollination is always mixing the genetic content of two different plants, it also going to bring the variations in offsprings. Now, this is very subjective actually, because if the variations are good, they are good for the plant, but if the variations are bad, then that becomes a disadvantage for in the case of cross pollination. Now, because the variations are bringing up in the plant, that actually makes the healthy and strong offsprings. Number four. It normally in so there are many plants which actually goes for a very, very high yield if they go for the cross pollination. So there are plants which actually have the option either to go for the self pollination or to go for the cross pollination, and what people have observed that when they go for the cross pollination, they are actually having the higher yield. One such plant is known as the mustard plant. So, mustard plant is going for a very, very high yield if the mustard is going for a cross pollination. So, let us discuss about the disadvantages of the cross pollination. So, as you remember, we have discussed that the major advantage of the cross pollination is that it actually allows the plant to evolve and get into new and advanced traits, because the pollen grains which are coming, they are coming from the different plant. But this is a kind of advantage only if the qualities which are coming from the neighboring plant are good. So, but imagine a situation where the plant species which is growing nearby has the bad traits, okay, or having a bad qualities, then these bad qualities are also coming into the picture. So, the ability of developing the new species probably can go into either in the good direction or into the bad direction, and that is the one of the disadvantage of the cross pollination. Because of this only, if you in India now, the farmers are very very careful about the sowing their field with the particular kind of crop. So what farmers are doing is they are trying to have the similar kind of crops in the neighboring field. For example, if you suppose one farmer has a crop in this field and another farmer has a crop in this field, and this is suppose a wild type species and this is a some advanced species or some you know transgenic species. Okay, so this transgenic species is considered to be slightly more superior compared to the wild type strain in terms of either the yield or in terms of getting the better protection against the pathogen and all that. But you can imagine if this farmer could not be able to protect their field by any mean, then the pollens will come from here and they will do the cross pollination, and that is going to dilute the number of transgenic plants which are present in this particular field, or ultimately it is actually going to affect the neighboring field as well. That is why when any such situation arises, either these two farmers are consulting with each other and they are actually asking to have the similar kind of crops, or the farmer the farmer which is going with the transgenic crops are actually some or other way are protecting their field, either by putting a curtain kind of situation, or they are putting a layer of trees. So if they put suppose eucalyptus tree or some other kind of bushy trees, that bushy trees probably may give slight protection against the cross pollination from the wild type species. But in other case, they also have the also mechanism to cover the field. Or sometime what they do is they somehow bring the additional field in between, so that the distances between these two fields goes up. Okay, and this is all the problems of the cross pollination. Number two, one of the major requirement of a cross pollination is that the flower should have the additional features. Flower should have the additional features in terms of having the different types of colors. Means the flower has to be very very beautiful, so that they should be attract the insects and other biotic factors. And on the other hand, they should produce scent, they should produce the nectars, and they should have the all other kind of requirement what we have discussed while we were talking about the cross pollination. So those kind of features are required. Okay, which means the process is not economical. Okay, which means what does that mean is the features what I am talking about is like the colored petals, presence of nectar, presence of scent, etcetera, etcetera. These features actually are putting a additional burden for the plant to an additional burden on its metabolic activities. For example, a plant has to produce different types of colors, and that actually will take up some amount of energy from the plant, and that actually will result into the lower production or the lower yield. So those things, that is why it is called as that these processes are not economical. Number three, since a factor is involved, a carrier is involved in the cross pollination, which actually will carry the pollen grain from the one plant to another plant, the process is very very uncertain. So the process is not foolproof, it is uncertain, is uncertain. You can imagine that suppose an insect which has taken a pollen grain from the salvia flower, but what is the probability that this flower, this particular insect will again go back to the salvia flower only? It may go back to some other flower as per its liking. So, although this never this probability is very low, but it could happen that a particular insect is pollinating the 5 different flowers and he may not follow the sequence. He may just follow from one flower to another flower and that may not be belonging to the same species, and because of that it will not going to add up into the cross pollination. Same is true for the birds and same is true for the other biotic strain. Number 4, which is more related to this only, the addition of undesirable features. So, this is all about the pollination in plant. So, what we have discussed about the cell pollination, we have discussed what are the strong points of cell pollination, we have also discussed about the cross pollination, and we also have gone through or discussed many types of agents which are involved in doing the cross pollination. Ultimately, we have also discussed the advantage as well as the disadvantages of both mode of pollination, either the cell pollination or the cross pollination. So, now what we are going to discuss, we are just going to briefly go through the comparative statement of both type of pollination to understand what are the advantages of a plant going through the cell pollination and what are the advantages of a plant going through the cross pollinations. So, as you can see on the PowerPoint slide, I have summarized the differences or the contrasting features of the cell pollination as well as the cross pollination. Okay, so what you can see on the PowerPoint, you can see that I have summarized the differences or the contrasting feature of cell pollination as well as the cross pollination. So, one of the feature is that in the case of cell pollination, the plant either should have the bisexual plant or the at least the plant should be of a monoecious condition, means the plant should have the male as well as the female flower on the same plant. Whereas, in the case of cross pollination, there is no such condition except that the plant should be dioecious, means plant should be having either the unisexual character or plant should be having the male or the female flower on the different plants. In the case of cell pollination, the external agent is not required, means there is no carrier involved, it actually becomes spontaneous, whereas in the case of cross pollination, the external agent is required. Cell pollination always gives the pure cell lines and it generates the offsprings which are mostly homozygous, whereas in the case of cross pollination, it creates lot of heterogeneity in the genetic system, genetic makeup. So, that actually brings the more variability in the system, whereas in the case of cell pollination, there is no variability. So, that actually does not allow to have the newer species, and because this particular plant cannot have the newer species, it may not be able to withstand the environmental as well as other kind of changes happening in the system. So, that may make this plant be more susceptible for the extinction. Whereas, in the case of cross pollination, since it is always been crossbreeding with the newer and newer traits, it could allow the evolution of the new species and which the additional features. The examples in the cell pollinations are mostly the crops which are important for the food production, that is wheat, rice, barley, pea, groundnut, tomato, potato, etc. Whereas, the examples in the case of cross pollinations are maize, bajra, cabbage, cauliflower, carrots, cucumber, apple, banana, etc. So, what we have discussed so far, we have discussed about the differences or the contrasting feature between the self as well as the cross pollination. So let's summarize. So far what we have discussed about the male reproductive system, and then we have also discussed that how these different types of how the male sex organ is producing the pollen grains, and how these pollen grains are going from one plant to another plant, or how they are migrating within the plant. But with this amount of knowledge, we have many queries and many questions which we have to understand or which we have to address. So I would like you to go through with these questions and think about them, and then we will discuss these questions in our next lecture. So what are these questions? These questions are as follows. As you can see on the PowerPoint, see what is chasmogamous flower? You can think about few examples, and you can also should think about the what are these flowers. You can also think about why the cross pollination, whether the cross pollination is possible in a chismogamous flower or not. On the other hand, we can also discuss, or you can also discuss among yourself, whether what are the different strategies the plants have evolved to prevent these self pollinations, and you can also go through with the websites and web sources to understand what is the bagging techniques and how it is useful in plant breeding programs. And lastly, we also I would like you to go through with the understanding about what is self incompatibility, and why there is a question why the plant which can actually do the self pollination as well as the cross pollination does not support the self pollination, and even if the any pollen grains go through with the self pollination, it does not lead to the formation of seeds in these self incompatible species. So what is the reason why the self pollination does not lead to the seed formation in self incompatible species? And then lastly, I would like you to go through with the literature to understand what is mean by the emasculation in plants. So with this we would like to summarize, or we would like to conclude our lecture here, and in our next lecture we are going to address these questions, and I'm sure you might be excited to know the answer of these questions. So I would urge you to either use the web sources or the other literature sources to at least attempt these questions. Thank you.